Hello Bookish friends, welcome to my top 5 favorite books of 2021. These books were of course my favorite books among the ones that I read in 2021. I have two things to say before I present the books that I've chosen. First of all, I did not include the rereads in this list, because Persuasion by Jane Austen would certainly be my number one book. Secondly, I really had a hard time deciding between the first and the second place. I went back and forth between those two books. The deciding factor was the writing style. The number one book has some elements that I would not like if they were written by a different author. But I would certainly recommend all of these 5 books. And lastly, I finished The First 15 Lives of Harry August. I buddy read this book with Tia and Mary Ellen. This book is really hard to define, but I will try to explain it as much as I can without giving spoilers. Harry August goes through his life again and again, being reborn with the memories of his previous life, and that really affects how he views the world every time he is born again. During his 15 lives, he encounters a situation in which the world is threatened and tries to save the world by using very different and unconventional methods. First of all, the body reading experience was really good. I enjoyed both of my body reading partners' points of view about the book. And then I have to say I was fascinated by the plot. The methods that they used to prevent this disaster was very, very clever, and the characters were also incredibly clever, because they had the knowledge of many, many lives. Additionally, I loved the philosophical, ethical, theological, and even existential questions this book asks all through the book, which made me think about them. And I loved the depiction of social and political events without having a politically biased agenda. But what made this book not perfect, but 9 out of 10, was the fact that, especially in the first half of the book, the jumps between different lives of Harry was confusing. Also, I have to say, maybe the plot demanded it, but the characters were not really likable or relatable. That's why it got a 9 out of 10, but it was a book that really made me think about a lot of things and made me exercise my brain. The next book that I finished in September was Flowers for Algernon by Daniel Keyes. This was the book that I was reading for my real life book club. It tells the story of a mentally disabled person whose IQ is increased with an operation, and how his life and his relationships with many people in his life changed after this operation. This book was one of the most powerful books that I have read in 2021. The plot was both emotional and also made me think about a lot of things. And the fact that the book was told in the first person point of view made it much more impactful while reading it. And because the story is told from progress reports, we can clearly see the progression of his increase in IQ, and then the following events that happens after he reaches a point of genius. And also the characters and their relationships were very interesting, and you feel so many emotions towards the main character, Charlie. And if it wasn't for a section in a book which was a bit preachy and tried to teach us the point that we were supposed to get from the book. I mean, it didn't have to tell it. It was clearly shown in the story. I don't know why the author decided to include that part. And if it wasn't for that part, I would have given this book a 10 out of 10. But because of that part, I gave this book 9 out of 10. But I strongly advise you to read this book. And I think it was the perfect fit for a book club book, because there are many things to be discussed after reading this book. The last book that I finished was the book that I was reading for every day as a buddy read with Gaia at Gaia Athena. And this book was clearly the favorite book of the month, although I read many good books, as I mentioned in the statistics. As an architect, I was not surprised that I would be interested in a book reading about a cathedral. But additionally, it had many layers that I liked in books. First of all, it had an engaging plot, and it described the time period very vividly. The tempo was very good. I never felt like I was reading a 1,000 pages book. Breaking it down in 28 days helped it a lot as well in that sense. But the book flowed very easily while reading it. That was a fact. And the book was clearly very well researched. And the author clearly had an interest in architectural history of the religious buildings. It confirmed all the points and things that we learned in architectural history lessons. Buildings are a symbol of power, and especially in the medieval times and before the medieval time, religious buildings and state buildings were symbols of power between the kings and the church. And the story clearly confirmed that thing, but not taking sides of state or religion, but taking sides of good people and bad people. And that was a very clever move done by the author, in my opinion, of course. And lastly, the most impressive thing about this book was how much I was invested in the characters. I loved Philip. I think he might be one of the best developed characters that I read in a book so far. He has faults, but he's very good-hearted and very lovable, and also very down-to-earth person. I additionally also really liked the characters of Tom, Elena, and Jack. And for evil characters, there was a character, William, which I thought of maybe getting into the book and killing him myself. That was how much I hated him while reading this book. And I never felt like that in maybe 5 years or so. So with all of these contributing factors and the fact that it's a very good story, I gave this book a perfect 10 out of 10. And I am very grateful that I get to share this wonderful experience with Gaia. It was really wonderful to fangirl about this book with her. The last book that I'm going to mention is another buddy read. I buddy read Still Alice by Lisa Genova with Hicks Picks Books. And it was featured on the video in which I mentioned top 5 books that I'm afraid to read because I would cry a lot. Becka and I decided to be a mini support group for each other and read this book together. Still Alice is a story of Alice Howland, who was a linguistic professor at Harvard. Right around her 50th birthday, she is diagnosed with early onset Alzheimer's. And this book is told from the point of view of Alice. We witness change in her condition through her own words, and how she views what is happening around her. This book might be the book that I had the hardest time to read. I had to read this book in small chunks, and I'm so glad we decided to spread it through 2 weeks, even though it was not a very long book. I had to take breaks between the chapters to think, to take breath, because I had a lump in my throat all the time while I was reading this book. But I cannot say this was a very sad book. The book told about the truth, the raw truth, without agitating our emotions. I actually cried a lot less than I expected it. Because I'm a big crier, but as I've said before, there was a lump in my throat, maybe which prevented me from crying. The fact that the book was written through Alice's point of view made the book much more impactful and also very, very emotional as well. But it was hard not to empathize with the other characters around Alice, especially her husband, who also goes through a very hard time along with her, and her two daughters and her son, who goes through this journey together. And lastly, I want to talk about Lisa Genova's writing. I think it was exceptional. It had very many scientific phrases, but I understood almost every single event in this book, because she described it so well, and it was actually very easy book to read in terms of tempo, the choice of words, and its realistic descriptions of all the events. Additionally, I would advise this fiction book to readers who mostly read nonfiction, because it really read like a memoir sometimes, because it felt so realistic. And after all these phrases, I could not think of giving this book a rating less than 10 out of 10. It was one of the best books that I have read in 2021. I will certainly read more books from Lisa Genova, because as I've said before, I think she's an exceptional writer. Second book that I have given 10 out of 10 this year, which was Remains of the Day by Kazuo Ishiguro. I previously talked about how The Pillars of the Earth was the only book that I have given 10 out of 10, but I started the second half of year with a very, very good book. This book talks about a butler called Stevens, who goes to a tour of English countryside, convinces his previous housemate to come back to work in the grand house that he works in, which is Darlington Hall. Up until reading this book, I never thought that I would have given a book that has almost no action and a very little plot development a rating of 10 out of 10. But I loved this book writing style so, so much. It was written so beautifully, and for the first time in many years, I really forced myself to read a book much more slower than my usual pace, to enjoy this little writing style in small doses, and I wanted to extend this wonderful reading experience as much as I can. I think the character of Stevens was both very clueless about life itself, also one of the most tragic characters that I have read in a book. One of the reviews that I read in Goodreads said that this book is about what did that happen. That was a wonderful description of this book. Additionally, the descriptions of nature, which I am not very fond of reading in books actually, was very beautiful, and I immensely enjoyed the descriptions of the English countryside, and I felt like I was there while I was reading that scenes. And the character of Stevens actually reminded me so much of the butler in Downton Abbey, Mr. Carlson. When I was reading this book, I kept hearing the actor's voice in my ears. Being a fan of that TV show, it was an additional joy to read this book. So everything just fitted perfectly for me, and that's why I gave this book a 10 out of 10. As for Turkish word of the day, I'm going to choose life. Life means hayat in Turkish, and hayat is our Turkish word of the day. Have a good day!